Well, good evening, everybody. Very warm welcome to you all to our Maundy Thursday Communion service. If you're visiting with us, a special word of welcome to you. And to those who are joining us, I know from Donegal and elsewhere, live, online, welcome to you guys too. Thanks for being with us. We are going to say some words of scripture together and then sing, "Be still for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here." The words will appear just on screen behind me here. And I'll do the verses in white, and we'll do the yellow one all together, shall we? This is the word of God, taken from Psalm 116. What shall I return to the Lord for all his goodness to me?
Together. I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord.
I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. If you'd like to stand with us, we're going to put up the words of the song, "Be Still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here." The presence of the Lord is in this place. What an amazing thought that God Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, by his Holy Spirit, would choose to be present where people gather to worship him in Jesus' name. Let's reflect on that as we pray together. Let me lead you first of all, and in a moment we'll say the Lord's Prayer together. Let's pray. Almighty God, gracious Father in heaven, we thank you for this opportunity to come away from all the bustle and din of the world, to come into this place to come into your holy presence, to come, as it were, into the very holy of holies, to meet with you between the wings of the cherubim in the Old Testament temple, the place where God would meet with Moses. Oh Lord, what a terrifying thought, to come into your holy presence, and we, so full of sin and corruption and failure, and yet we don't have to be afraid, because you have given us both the priest and the offering in our Jesus, your Son, our Savior. And so we come and are not afraid to call you Father, for Jesus makes us so when we trust in him. We are your children. You've given us that power, that right, that privilege, because we have taken refuge in your Son, the one, the Lamb of God, who gave his body and blood on the cross of Calvary, that we might be forgiven and made good and fit for your table. So, Father, accept the praise, the thanksgiving that we offer to you tonight. Help us to listen carefully to your word, and more, to respond to it with willing and obedient hearts and minds. Show us what you want us to do, and give us the courage and the character to do it. And, O God, would you be glorified in Cairncastle tonight as we praise you, as we pray to you, as we bring our obedient hearts, and as we go from here, fed and nourished by the sacrament, to serve you in all our ways. So, Lord, will you speak to us tonight? Will you be our guest of honor by your Spirit? Will you lead us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake? Will you commune with us and allow us to commune with you and with one another? May this be a blessed few moments that we spend together in your holy presence. May we know your grace. May we know your peace. And may we know your commissioning as your servants to go from here to serve in Jesus' name. We pray in that name, the name of the Savior, the Son of God, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who taught his followers to pray like this: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We are reading tonight from John's Gospel, chapter 18. And I perhaps should just warn you, it is quite a long reading, but there's a lot in here. So let's listen carefully to God's word this Maundy, Thursday evening. John 18, I'm reading from verse 28. This is God's word. Then the Jews led Jesus from Caiaphas to the palace of the Roman governor. By now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanness, the Jews did not enter the palace. They wanted to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" "If he were not a criminal," they replied, "we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." "But we have no right to execute anyone," the Jews objected. This happened so that the words Jesus had spoken, indicating the kind of death he was going to die, would be fulfilled. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" "Is that your own idea?" Jesus asked, "or did others talk to you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "It was your people and your chief priests who handed you over to me. What is it you have done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jews. But now, my kingdom is from another place." "You are a king then," said Pilate. Jesus answered, "You are right in saying I am a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." "What is truth?" Pilate asked. With this, he went out again to the Jews and said, "I find no basis for a charge against him. But it is your custom for me to release to you one prisoner at the time of the Passover. Do you want me to release the King of the Jews?" And they shouted back, "No, not him. Give us Barabbas." Now Barabbas had taken part in a rebellion. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. The soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They clothed him in a purple robe and went up to him again and again, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and they struck him in the face. Once more, Pilate came out and said to the Jews, "Look, I'm bringing him out to you to let you know I find no basis for a charge against him." Now, when Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." As soon as the chief priests and their officials saw him, they shouted, "Crucify! Crucify!" But Pilate answered, "You take him and crucify him. As for me, I find no basis for a charge against him." The Jews insisted, "We have a law, and according to that law, he must die, because he claimed to be the Son of God." When Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid. He went back inside the palace. "Where do you come from?" he asked Jesus. But Jesus gave him no answer. "Do you refuse to speak to me?" Pilate said. "Don't you realize I've power either to free you or to crucify you?" Jesus answered, "You would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to set Jesus free, but the Jews kept shouting, "If you let this man go, you're no friend of Caesar. Anyone who claims to be a king opposes Caesar." When Pilate heard this, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judge's seat at a place known as the stone pavement. It was the day of preparation of Passover week, about the sixth hour. "Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews. But they shouted, "Take him away, take him away, crucify him." "Shall I crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the chief priests answered. Finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified. So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, Golgotha. And here they crucified him. With him two others, one on each side, and Jesus in the middle. Amen. May God bless his word to us this evening. We're going to sing another hymn just now. "Beneath the cross of Jesus, I fain would take my stand."
Jesus, I fain would take my soul.
Here is a sad and cynical question which the Roman governor Pilate asks while interrogating Jesus. He says, "What is truth?" It's understandable. The uncomfortable truth that Pilate knows well is that, humanly speaking, this is a setup. It's the culmination of a jealous vendetta by Jewish leaders, desperate to cling on to their limited power. And Pilate understands that because so's he. Word of unrest in Palestine must not get back to the Emperor Tiberius in Rome, or Pilate will be out of a job. Indeed, he could forfeit his life. And so he and the Jewish leaders, they're all going to do what is politically expedient. They're going to crucify the innocent preacher from Galilee, whose teaching has excited some of the people. Apparently, this happens all the time, or at least frequently, all over the world. Authorities do what they feel they must to keep order. Whatever deal is deemed politically correct at the time, culturally acceptable to those making the most noise, or just the best damage limitation possible. These things are often quickly and sometimes ruthlessly put into operation. By tomorrow night, there will be some different story on the tea time news to distract everyone. Life will go on as usual, they hope. Now, this is the only truth that Pontius Pilate has ever known. He's built his career on it. So not for the first time, he suppresses what's left of his conscience and he signs the death warrant. Sends an innocent man to the gallows. Oh, but there's far more to the truth than Pilate and many others might wish to see. The truth is there is a higher throne. There is a much higher judgment seat than his, or that of any human authority. It's not Jesus who is on trial. It's Pilate and the high priest Caiaphas and the Sanhedrin. They are being weighed in the balances of Almighty God and found sorely wanting. Spiritually empty, morally bankrupt, they face the judgment of heaven's court. Truth? The truth is, the clock is ticking, and time is running out for these men and for a world that thinks we know better than God. There will be a day that we all must stand before Almighty God and give account of ourselves and the choices we have made. The Apostle John was eyewitness to these sordid events in Jerusalem that Passover week. He records them accurately for us, but he doesn't end there. We're glad to say that's not the whole truth, far from it. It's an uncomfortable, unpleasant, human, corrupt aspect of it. It's part of the whole picture, but it's only part of it. And the Apostle John writes of another part of the truth. Not just our shameful human compromise. No, John's whole purpose in writing is to proclaim the gospel, the good news of Jesus. Jesus, the eternal Son of God, who has come into the world from the Father, full of grace and truth, to be the Savior of all who will believe. And we've been reading about this in John's gospel over the last weeks and months here in Cairncastle. The divine word became flesh and made his home among us, that whosoever receives him and believes in his name is granted power to become children of God and will not perish, but have eternal life. That's part of the truth too. Jesus is the source of all light and life. He has come into a world that is lost in darkness, yes, but Jesus has come preferring not to condemn us yet, but to save us if we're willing. And John has presented us with numerous examples of people discovering this light, this life, this salvation, this good news. There were the guests at the wedding party where Jesus multiplied the wine so that they could go on celebrating love. There was the Pharisee Nicodemus. There was the woman at the well in Samaria. There was a disabled man. There was a blind man. There was a dead man. A woman almost stoned to death for serious sin, but given another chance by Jesus. Jesus says that those who hold on to and practice his teaching are really his disciples, who know the truth and are liberated by it. Do you see? The truth is not just our sinful failure, our wicked compromise, our corruption. Yes, that's an uncomfortable part of it. But as John continues to reveal what happens next, we see there's much more to the truth than that. The truth is also the grace of God in Jesus. And when we trust in him, we are set free from sin. That guilt, that shame, we don't have to carry the burden of it anymore. The binding habits, they're broken. We don't have to submit to them any longer. The hopeless pursuits of darkness, no, we're not limited to that anymore. We can celebrate abundant life and light, life in all its fullness to the glory of God. This is the truth of the good news. What do we find as we read through John's gospel? We find Jesus offering himself to us as the bread of life from heaven to satisfy our deepest longings. He offers the living water of the Holy Spirit in chapter 14 called the Spirit of Truth to bring us to new birth spiritually and constantly refresh and sustain us. As good shepherd, Jesus lays down his life for the sheep. As the true vine, he assures his followers of the strength and the support that we need. He promises resurrection and a secure home for all in his Father's heavenly house. Oh, this is also the truth. Aren't we glad? This is the truth, the good news of Jesus. What is truth, says Pilate? The only truth he knows is human failure and corruption. But there's a much greater truth on the pages here of Scripture. The good news of Jesus. The only way for sinners like us to approach the judgment seat of God and call him Father. I am the way, Jesus declares. I am the truth and the life. And on the cross we see the truth of God's holiness and grace demonstrated most fully. On the cross, Jesus puts into effect this truth of God's holiness and love, both side by side. God's uncompromising holiness coupled with his amazing grace and love for people. You see, God detests our sin. He hates it when we rebel, when we disobey. But he loves us dearly. And so on the cross, we see these two things perfectly together. Justice is satisfied. Sin is atoned for, as holiness demands, by the offering of the pure and perfect Lamb of God. And all of this mercy and forgiveness and generous blessing of God's love and eternal life comes to us, paid for by our Lord's suffering, which we remember on the table tonight in these symbols of bread and wine, his body, his blood given for us. So the way is cleared by Jesus' suffering on the cross. The truth, the good news is made plain. The life is offered to all who will receive it. And Jesus prays that we might come from darkness to light and be saved and made holy in the fellowship of God's people. By this truth found in the Word of God.
Jesus, Son of God, Savior of the world. The Holy Spirit, sent to live in the hearts of his followers. The Word of God, written in Scripture. These are the truth, the greatest, most vital truth the world needs to hear. This is the message that brings us from death to life. And eyewitness John is absolutely unapologetic about his agenda as he comes towards the end of his gospel. He's not writing as an impartial reporter. He's not like a journalist saying, well, here's a few thoughts and make up your own mind. Oh, no, he's saying, listen, I'm telling you, this Jesus is the Son of God, and you need to trust in him. I want you to trust in him. Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples that are not recorded in this book, John says. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. When we love Jesus, we want everyone to love Jesus. We want everyone to be his disciples. When we follow him, however imperfectly, it saddens us that not everybody follows him. It hurts us that people who we know and love, perhaps members of our own family, good friends or associates, who we love dearly and respect in so many ways, yet seem indifferent, impervious to Jesus and his love, and aren't interested. They don't seem to want to know. But we want them to know. We want them to believe. Christians want other people to become Christians too. For this cause, John and the other apostles gave up their homes, their careers, to preach far and wide this truth of the good news of Jesus. Most of them were eventually martyred for their faith. And yet, 2,000 years later, this truth of Jesus remains and continues to transform lives in every corner of every continent today. Now, we who profess to know the Lord must share this passion, this enthusiasm. We must pray earnestly, and we must be willing to speak and tell others the gospel and demonstrate it by our actions so that we might see, by his grace, family, friends, neighbors come to know Jesus too. Because, listen, it's not just Pilate and Caiaphas who are on trial here. The whole world stands guilty before its maker. And you and I are being weighed today in the balances of the Almighty. What might his verdict be on us tonight? May it not be Cairncastle. May it not be sadly condemned because they loved darkness rather than light. Their deeds were evil. Rather, may it be saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ to live abundantly and to serve obediently and fruitfully to the glory of God. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. God, our Father in heaven, we thank you for the truth that is before us. Thank you for the honesty of the Bible. We see sometimes uncomfortable reflections of ourselves. We see people who would do something unethical just to keep the peace, just to keep things the way they like them. We see corruption, we see human failure and sin, and it's ugly. But we also see the amazing grace of you and Jesus Christ whom you sent. And O Lord, tonight we pray, this Easter, this message would come home to us more powerfully than ever before, that your Holy Spirit would impress these truths deep in our minds and our hearts, that we would be moved from our complacency and really motivated to serve you with all of our hearts for your glory in this place where you've called us. So to you be the praise and the thanksgiving tonight. Thank you for your word. May it not be lost on us or wasted, but rather may it accomplish that for which you have purposed and sent it. We bring our prayer in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. We're going to sing again a communion hymn, We Come As Guests Invited. Let's again hear God's word from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. It's the Apostle Paul writing. He's writing to the church in Corinth, which he describes as being a little bit immature because, well, while they had some gifted speakers and they were quite enthusiastic in some ways, yet their relationships were, well, they weren't great. And when they would come to have communion together, some of them would just carry on and blatantly ignore everybody else. And so he writes this chapter particularly about communion, and in it he is actually having to correct them a bit and say, now look, you can't just do this selfishly or thoughtlessly. You have to do this most humbly. These things represent our Lord Jesus Christ. This is a sacrament given us by the Lord himself. And so we must do this with the utmost reverence for him and a humble love for one another. And so some of the words he writes in 1 Corinthians 11 are actually quite stern and challenging. And then we come to verse 23, where he writes, inspired by the Spirit, "For I received from the Lord, from Jesus himself, what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given it, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Amen. May God bless his word to us this evening. At the Last Supper, Jesus did really something very simple, but that was actually genius. He took something that's universal. He took the food that was on the table. He took bread and the drink, which we assume was wine, and he made them symbols of himself and created this sacrament that we call communion, something that could be repeated in every country, every culture on earth where there is food and drink. Well, that's everywhere. And so it's obvious that he was inviting people from all nations, all backgrounds, to trust in him and to come to the Father's table, to take these symbols of him and to be fed by him, by his Spirit, that we might follow him obediently and serve him fruitfully as our Lord. And so we have an invitation and indeed an instruction from Jesus that if we trust him, if we love him, if we're Christian, if we're seeking to follow him, then this is something that we should consider doing. We should come to the sacrament and we should participate in faith and in obedience to him. But we also have the word of caution. It's something that we must not. Here side by side, as so often in Scripture, we find encouragement and also challenge. If we will accept the challenge, then the encouragement comes all the more strongly as we realize and sense the love of Jesus for his people. If you're visiting with us tonight, if you love Jesus and you would like to take part in the sacrament, you're most welcome to do so. Let's do as Jesus did the night of the Last Supper. We're told that he gave thanks for the table and the bread and wine on it that would become symbols of him. Let's do that now, shall we? Let's pray. O God, our Father in heaven, we thank you that you are a holy God, that you care about right and wrong. We thank you that someone does, and that you do hold us accountable. And yet that worries us because we all have sinned and fallen short of your glory in so many different ways. Things we've said or done, things that we should have done but didn't do. Times that we have just lived our lives so focused on ourselves and what would please us and not often thought of what might please you first. So we have to come confessing our sin and asking that the blood Jesus shed, the body that was broken on Calvary, would be the propitiation, the atonement for our sins. That through our Lord's sacrifice there on that Good Friday, we might be forgiven. We might be cleansed. We might know the assurance of your loving grace and mercy. So, dear Lord, we thank you for this table and for these symbols, this bread, this wine. Thank you that now they may become for us remembrances of your Son, our Savior. We pray, O Lord, that you would help us to participate in this sacrament together with tremendous reverence for you, with tremendous thanksgiving and love for this great love that you poured out for us when you gave us your Son. We pray, O Lord, Lord Jesus, risen Lord, no longer dead and in the tomb, Lord, but risen and ascended and sitting at the Father's right hand and coming one day in glory, Lord. We pray that you would meet us here tonight at this table. And as we do this in remembrance of you, in obedience to your word, Lord, will you meet us and commune with us and feed us spiritually? Build up our hearts and our minds and our wills in your truth, the truth of your love and the great salvation you provided at the cross. So, O God, hear these and all our prayers this evening. We offer in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's declare our faith together. I think we have the Apostles' Creed, and I think it would be good if we stood and said this together. So can I invite you to stand just in your place where you are, and before we take the bread and wine, we declare what it is that we believe in. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Now you'll see, hopefully on the way in, you've got a little piece of bread and a little piece of wine. Let's take that piece of bread together now. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." Together. Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that this story doesn't end with the cross, not even with the resurrection. The end is still to come because you've still to come to return to this earth in glory to bring your church home, to be with you forever. Dear Lord, help us to be people who live in anticipation of that great climax. We thank you. We thank you for this table, this bread, this wine. We thank you for you and for your great love for us. We pray, O Lord, that we might rise from this table refreshed and strengthened by your Spirit, instructed by your word, united in fellowship, to go from here to serve you fruitfully as you will lead. Dear Lord, will you hear us as we pray for our dear ones, family and neighbors and friends? We pray that all might know you, trust you as Savior, and follow you as Lord. We pray that in your grace, all these might one day be saved and know the joy of your salvation. We pray, O Lord, that you would not forsake us or pass us by, but you would be pleased to hear our prayer and pour out a blessing of grace, saving grace, redeeming grace in this place for your honor and glory. Hear these and all our prayers which we offer in the name of our crucified and risen Lord Jesus. Amen. Our closing praise this evening, the hymn, "There Is Our Redeemer." We stand to sing. Let's say our closing prayer together, the grace. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.